Hello. Does anyone know what time it is? Should I start or?
Yes.
Great. So, hello everybody. I'm Ólafur. I work at the ScalaCenter. Today I'm going to give a talk on how to refactor with scalafix, which is a library and tool that I'm working on, and scala.meta, which is a library that scalafix uses. And I think you all had a talk earlier today from Eugene on Meta. So very briefly about myself, I finished my master's last year from EPFL. And now I'm part-time employed by the center to work on this, and then the rest of the time I'm actually not working. So I worked on a formatter called scala.fmt, and it produces a bunch of diffs like this. And the talk today is not about scala.fmt, but it's about a tool that does a very similar thing. It also produces lots of diffs, but the diffs are very different because now it's inserting tokens and removing tokens, whereas the formatter is constrained to just white space and new lines. So just to compare. So I want to talk about, I want to motivate this talk, and I know there was another talk from Matthias today on Scala refactoring. So we're at a developer tools conference. I don't know how much motivation is required here. You flew all the way to Krakow, but still, I'll try to explain what motivates me, and then I'm going to have one tool demo and one library demo at the end. And before I show the library demo, I want to go a bit into the internals of scalafix. So. Why? I think I like this one. Everyone are maybe familiar with the move fast and break things mantra at Facebook. And I want to say we should move fast and refactor things instead, and preferably automatically, right? So, and scalafix is a library and tool. This one was in the wrong place. Wait a second. I had gonna start here. All right, so the main thing is that the motivation for scalafix originally comes because Martin Rodesky is working on a new compiler at EPFL, and they want to be able to evolve the language quickly, introduce new language features, and remove old features. So there are several cases where this is one that they're considering for the Scala C team. They want to drop there's a language flag to enable so that you can write postfix operators. It's the same as infix, but there's no argument. I've seen this in old code bases, but I rarely ever see this in modern Scala. So it'd be nice if we could just remove it and then automatically. No. This plays terribly with a lot of other syntax, in my opinion. So I'd be really happy to see that. Another thing in Dottie is Dottie requires explicit type annotations for implicit definitions, for public implicit definitions. So if, and this may be a problem if you've been using type inference. And some of them are quite hairy. So it'd be quite annoying if you'd have to go into your code base and start typing everything. And especially the hairy ones, maybe IntelliJ won't figure out automatically. So it'd be nice if we had a tool that could use the types from the compiler and insert them, because the compiler infers them, Scala C too, so maybe we can just shove them into the code, but there are some challenges behind that too. And this is maybe more like a quality of life. Everyone are maybe familiar, we have to write pattern matches here, but why can't we just write it like that instead? I think in Dottie this is possible. It adapts the arity of the function, And but now we have a bunch of code using the old pattern, which is basically not necessary anymore. Then we'll have new Scala developers come in and learn from the old code. And then everyone keep on writing this, even though they could be writing this. We can have nice things. So it'd be nice to just upgrade everyone's written to the new syntax. But it's so this was the beginning of ScalaFix, and I was focused on this. I started working on it last in August. But then a lot of people came up to me and were asking, "Oh, can it do these things? Can it migrate this library for me, etc." And I was like, "Yes, well, obviously it can, because it can also migrate language features. It's the same. It's basically just the same stuff. But then you're doing it from library to library." And then there are just a whole endless bath of ideas that people are coming up with. This is the cats library deprecated their XOR, which was pretty much very similar to either. And I saw some diffs in some large repos where people were just manually doing this mechanical thing. And I thought that would be quite nice to automate. And I'm sure that when they're debating in the issue tracker whether they should deprecate XOR, a big cost in this analysis is saying, like, "Oh, but people have to go through the manual process." Like, it's a parameter into this decision-making process. And maybe, you know, it'd be cool if we can lower the cost of this migration, then we can maybe afford to make maybe a more better choice. Right. So because some good ideas are not always good because the migration cost is very high. So this is an idea that there are some guys playing. Actually, this is a thing that's in the works. So the way that you just say, I have a project, cross project, and I write, you know, I cross build to JVM, to JS, and to 10 and to 11, etc. You just cross build to Scala Z2 or you cross build to cats. And there's a working prototype, and then when you do compile in the Scala Z project, it actually just takes the cat's sources and rewrites them to the Scala Z and then compiles it. So all behind the scenes, you don't have to, it's quite heavily integrated with SPT. And I think that's really cool. And this is another, I think, brilliant idea that was brought up by a guy called Shane, who's been quite actively contributing ideas to the project. He was saying, wouldn't it be cool if you know, when you you upgrade a library dependency, and then you get all sorts of new deprecations saying this has been renamed into that, and then you could just say ScalaFix, and that just removes all the deprecation warnings. And we could just parse the rewrites out of these messages and then run them on the source code that you have. We have the file names and the locations and all sorts of information. So I think this would be actually quite a low-hanging fruit and a nice quality of life thing. So I want to just do, I'm not going to sit down and compile like a really large project because it takes a while. So my plan instead was to show kind of how the process of using ScalaFix as a tool today is. It's you can add an SPT plugin. We saw the Hydra team. This is a very popular kind of user interface now. Add an SPT plugin and run a command. And God forbid that the internet works now. Right. It's cool. So I forked Slick. And there is, you can write configuration in a Hocon format, .scalafix config. It's very simple. I disabled all rewrites, but I have an organize imports, which is like built into the framework. Because if you want to remove or add imports, etc., you kind of need to have a full control over all imports instead of trying to infer what the user were writing. And then it produced a diff with quite a huge number of diffs. The reason why there are so many additions is that it's configurable, but I really don't like the curly brace grouping by prefix. I think it produces ugly diffs during code reviews, so I prefer to actually have a single line per import, even though it's 50 lines of code at the top of the file. But it's possible to say tell ScalaFix to group them by prefix too. And there we go. Another, there are some still, like as you can see, there's one redundant new line that's being inserted, and that's an open issue. And one cool feature is that this organize imports can remove unused imports too. It's a compiler plugin, and it uses the unused imports compiler flag from the compiler. So if you're having any sort of unused import warnings, ScalaFix can just remove those warnings by removing the imports. Currently only for the global imports, not for local imports, but that's for a future thing. So I think this is quite cool. And I test this as in Slick is actually an integration test in CI right now. So every PR actually will run the latest version on Slick and make sure that the project compiles after running the refactoring. And I think this is a general maybe user experience. I remember trying out Eclipse, and it's the same for IntelliJ. You do some refactorings, and then just your project is broken after you did some automatic fix. And I think this is quite annoying, and I think it you lose faith in tooling when it doesn't work as you expect it to. So I really want to aim for having it, if it compiles before, you run ScalaFix, it compiles afterwards. And I think that's a really nice place to be in. Cool. So let me go into here. And so there is nothing magical about the SPT plugin. It's actually mostly boilerplate to deal with the SPT update task and the reason because SPT is stuck on 2.10. All it does is just add a flag with a path to the jar of the compiler plugin. So it's if you're using a different build tool, you're not left out. And there we go. So I think a big question maybe that people may be wondering right here now is how is this compared to IntelliJ Scala? There's a section on refactoring too. People have been doing organized imports in IntelliJ for years, 10 years so, I guess. And it's not so exciting anymore. It's 2017. And I think that the big difference here is that ScalaFix is command line first. It's focusing on batch mode. And you can run this in your CI. I don't think you can run the IntelliJ organize imports in CI. That would be a cool feature for the...
I think probably you can in the headless mode.
In the headless mode, I'm sure, yeah, you know. So I've never tried, but I'm sure it's doable. Because I think this is quite what people appreciate, especially today now with continuous integration, that you can guard against, you know, check this on every PR. And then another difference is that the types and symbols that we're using are pulled out of the Scala compiler. And this is especially so warning unused imports. I think I'm quite familiar with IntelliJ warning on implicit imports as being not used. And then you organize someone, comes into the project, maybe the new guy on the team clicks on organize imports and now the project doesn't build and they're really scared what happened. So I think we want to avoid this sort of like refactor into a broken project. So this is maybe the biggest difference I would say. I'm really excited though. I think they're working on Migrators API and I use IntelliJ all day. I love it. So I'm really excited to see what they're going to bring there. So in terms of refactoring, it's using information from the Scala compiler as well, but it's built on top of ScalaMeta, which is like a clean room implementation of like a language model of Scala. So have you heard of ScalaMeta before? I guess before the talk today or before today? Okay, cool. And then another big difference, it's more batch mode focused. ScalaFix is not so heavily focused at to begin with. Like I'm personally not so focused on doing integrations with the IDEs so that these insights or inspections are available in real time within 100 milliseconds. I'm totally fine with it taking 30 seconds. It's still, you know, or you know, just as long as it takes to compile your project, basically. I think that's fine. And what's really nice is when you take that trade-off and say, we're not so heavily focused on these sub-millisecond response times. I think we can take different trade-offs. more maybe in terms of correctness, which give us some leverage. And I think that's a nice way to look at it. So I wrote like a table to see kind of where it fits. This is ScalaFix, which is using ScalaMeta. I would say that syntax is basically just what you see in a text file. So that would be if you have four comprehensions or if you wrote like an infix application, let's say 1 plus 2, or if you wrote 1.+(2). That is syntax. They're identical semantically. So from what I know with Scala Refactoring, they're working with the trees from the compiler for syntax and semantics. And as I saw your talk last year, Matthias, there is a challenge with syntax, because so much information is lost in the desugaring phase, and it's practically in the parser. There is no phase before. If you go into the first phase of the compiler, an incredible amount of information is lost, and it's more than four comprehensions. It's infix applications, it's patterns on the eval assignments. It's quite a lot. Primary constructors in classes, for example. Case classes, I think, are even desugared before. So annotations will move all over the place. So it's really, you're doing like you need to reverse engineer what's happening in the compiler, and then you need to figure out whether the user wrote used infix application or not. Whereas ScalaMeta has its own abstract syntax tree and its own parser, and it preserves the full information of what was written in the source file, but we're still pulling out types and symbols from the compiler instead of re-implementing our own type checker. And so in IntelliJ Scala, they have their own PSI elements and their own incremental type checker. And I think that's really, the reasoning is rock solid for instant feedback, incremental type checking with these. And I'm always impressed in IntelliJ how I can rename in a code that doesn't type check. It can, like, and surprisingly often this is very useful. So ScalaFix is not trying to solve that use case. So now I'm gonna explain a bit maybe what really is ScalaFix about. If you have any questions, don't hesitate to just raise a hand and stop me. So I really want to highlight, first of all, that ScalaFix is no magical big library. It's less than 1,000 lines of code, only dealing with doing rewrites and code transformations. It's a minor application of Meta, which is a fairly large project. And the majority of my time for the last months has been working on the Meta side. So I think this diagram shows quite a bit like the ambition or the vision of the project is to, for we are here at a developer tools conference, and a lot of us are doing Meta programming. We want to manipulate source code. We want to do code search, etc., macros, and formatters and refactoring tools. And the vision is that Scala is popular enough that we have several compilers targeting Scala, including IntelliJ Scala. There's Dotty, Scala C, we have Hydra, type level Scala. That's quite a lot of things happening. And if you want to have a refactoring tool that supports all of these, you can see the complexity at each endpoint on the right-hand side, because you need to take care of each of them. So the ambition is that you can just write against this unified API, and Meta will do some of the quirks. So some of the work that's happening maybe here in Paradise, it's actually called Scala Host now, is re-sugaring some of the stuff from Scala C. And now I'm gonna go through quite a few type signatures, which there are basically only these three that I want to explain. So if you want to use I showed you earlier just as a tool, just add an SPT plugin, and then you just go and you get the out of the box custom made, like ready out of the box rewrites. But it's a library too, and you can write your own custom ad hoc migration refactoring steps. And maybe the motivation, you might think like, oh no, I'm not going to write a custom rewrite for my company. But I'm hoping to, at the end of this talk, you'll see that, hey, I can actually maybe write this in 5 minutes and run this on my, you know, for my company. And that's going to be a really valuable thing to bring into when you're making new decisions in how you're going to organize your internal code base. And there are basically three types that I want to explain. So a rewrite is basically a function from a rewrite context to a sequence of patches. And I'll explain why we need the T. So the context is just a bundle of all sorts of things that are useful to have in scope. So you can just say import CTX and then continue. And then you have a scala.meta tree. You have the tokens for a single source file. And then you have a scalafix config. This is where you want to maybe say, oh, you're grouping by prefix, or you want, you know, whatever that you want to define via configuration. And then it's the magical mirror, which is the semantic model, which you may have heard about today from Eugene. And it's the mirror T is basically probably only in the end going to be two values, so you can just type alias them. But I wasn't really sure what to put there. I didn't like doing like an option of a mirror, so I decided to just make it a T and then deal with it later. So the thing is that you can do syntactic rewrites. It's not always the case that you need semantic information. For example, if you want to, I have a Scala, the formatter, has 8 or 10 rewrite rules at the moment that are purely syntactic. For example, avoid infix. It rewrites infix application into regular applications where you're using infix applications in places where it shouldn't be used. And I think infix syntax is used way too much, to be honest. I like it for symbolic methods. So syntactic rewrites don't need any sort of mirror. So it's a mirror. It can be any. So the rewrite is contravariant to the T. So you can fit it into any sort of mirror. It doesn't matter if you have semantic information or not, you can run it. And then the scala.meta mirror is the semantic API. It's basically, you had a talk today about semantic API, and the mirror is the semantic API, and currently enabled with SPT Scala host or Scala host. And ScalaFix has its own compiler plugin, and scala.meta mirror came out after I'd been working quite a while on ScalaFix. It only came out like 2 weeks ago. So now ScalaFix mirror extends scala.meta mirror with two methods. It's to remove unused imports. And I'd like to contribute this upstream into scala.meta mirror when I can. But there are currently some rewrites that take advantage of. Another one, it's the explicit type annotations for implicit vals. So I wasn't really sure. I had three cases, and then I just thought, well, I'm just going to put a T there. But hopefully, we'll only have to deal with these two. But maybe there'll be more. So now the last type is patch. So a key design choice in scala.meta is to have tokens and trees, or trees and tokens. So many. It's really appealing, the idea of like an abstract syntax tree and only having abstract syntax trees and doing transformations on abstract syntax trees. But I personally think that it complicates some things when you can just do stuff on the token level. So some things are really easy to do on pure tokens. And what's really nice with tokens is that they're what you see on a source file. Like we are writing on the token level, as like when we're coding in a text editor, you're just operating on tokens. Like, oh, I want to remove this dot. You don't have to know what the syntax tree for it is, you just remove the dot. And this is the same, like some rewrites are really easy to do if you're just operating on tokens. You don't have to even worry about what tree it is. Whereas some rewrites are really complicated on the token level, and then you want to just work on the tree level. So the plan with patch is that it's just a small sealed ADT or you know, it's a small algebra of operations that you can collect, and then basically tree patches in the end get converted into token patches, and then in the end we evaluate these token patches. And that's it's really easy to evaluate token patches because they're so low level, as we'll see. So basically, there are only two, pretty much. You can remove a token, and you can add something to the, prepend or append to it. It's roughly like this. It's a bit more tricky, but at the end of the to apply them, you basically just you can combine them into one patch, and then you run them on all tokens in the source file. And so, I don't know how familiar you are with other refactoring libraries, but many of them work on buffers. Like I know, for example, I believe the CLang tooling to do patches works on buffers. And what's problematic, I've heard, is you need to, let's say you want to remove this token now, and then there are some other edits on tokens before, you have to make sure that the offsets remain the same correctly. So what's really nice, we never have to worry about this because each token gets its own instance of a class. So it's quite heavy on the memory because we create one token per space and a source file with 10,000 lines of code. We'll say 30 characters on each line. It's going to be 30,000 tokens or something, roughly, maybe. So tree patches is a way, way higher level API, which then ScalaFix provides implementation to convert these into token patches. But you don't have to worry about that. These are very high level and they compose quite nicely. So if you're doing all sorts of, if you do add the same global import twice, you don't have to worry about it. Or if you're adding a global import that already exists, you don't have to worry about it. Or if you're removing something that doesn't exist, you don't worry about it, etc. So, and then rename is if it's just a single identifier. And this one is actually not from a symbol, it's just a single instance of a name. Like. Whereas replace is just taking a symbol, and it could be a full prefix like the XOR case, like XOR dot write. We want to replace that full path to write. So these are just I kind of created them on the fly while I needed them, and it implementing them the interpreters for these takes 10-15 minutes. It wasn't really complicated. So this is very up in the air. The implement like how many we want, etc. If you want to be able to provide custom implementations, etc. So in the end, we can just convert the tree patches to the token patches. So, yeah?
One very small question. Mm-hmm. Have you also thought about the possibility of renaming files and moving files around? Does it might also be necessary sometimes?
Yeah, so the question was if I have considered about renaming files or moving files on the file system. No, I have not. But that is definitely relevant for this sort of things. Move this file, yeah. And what happens then, you have to deal with imports, etc. So especially these are per source file. A rewrite, as you see, the context is heavily dependent on one single source file. But if you need to do like a project-wide one, I haven't been doing that yet so far. So this is just an example of a very simplistic syntactic rewrite. We don't need any sort of API. It could be like a syntactic rewrite val if you want to do it that way. I'm still really, it's really rough, the API, but let's say that if we see seek, just the name or the type of seek, then we just want to add an import on Scala collection immutable seek. I think this was a revelation, like when I realized that Scala seek regular one could be mutable, I think I caught one bug once and it was just, I've been burnt since then. Now I put immutable seek everywhere, and I've realized that I somehow need immutable seek to import in most files now. So this is a simple one, and as you can see, you don't have to worry about any low-level details. So let's say we'd like to do this on a semantic. So previously, we didn't know that seek is actually the Scala standard library seek. We wanted to know We wanted to know that it was just any seek. So if the user would create a variable called seek, then we'd import Scala collection immutable seek, and that's not good, right? So now, enabled by the ScalaMeta semantic API that came out 2 weeks ago, we can get symbols. And the syntax may seem quirky at the moment. So what we do, we needed this implicit mirror in context, which is provided by the context. And so what we need is an application, like a constructor of a seek, for example. So if I just write seek by itself, that'd just be referencing the companion object, I believe. Whereas we need to do an application. It needs to be the symbol of the construction of a seek. But I only care about the name seek, so I just extract it out of the here. And now we can just say, well, if it's the same as, you know, if it's the same method as this one there, this one will actually type check this quasi quote and fetch the symbols provided by it and compare them. So I understand this is a bit weird, and this is because just maybe the API is really new still, we're learning.
Question, case seek dot apply dot will not work in a collect.
No, exactly, because it's from the generic companion apply. But we don't have to worry about it. We just write but the nice thing is that we only write the syntax that we know. So the general idea is that we follow syntax. And like, if you know how to write this, you can know what symbol it has. One other way to implement the same thing is just to print out what symbol it is. I'll show you just later how to print out a full symbol for a single compilation unit. And then you can just copy paste like this full qualified symbol, and then that'll work, right? So I think this, yeah, right. So I had already explained this, that ScalaFix mirror is just a subtype of mirror, and it has, I'm experimenting now with the deprecated stuff because I think it's really low-hanging fruit to get the deprecated warning messages. And I plan to merge it with the mirror. So this pretty much concludes what I wanted to show in the talk, but there is a small summary in the end, but I wanted to do, how much time do I have?
Something about 10 minutes, 12.
All right, so I was hoping to motivate you to give the library a try. So I want to do a bit of coding and show just how we're going to implement a small rewrite that in IntelliJ.
Sorry.
So
a little bit more time.
I have a bit more time. Cool. So it's not a Gitterate template yet, but it's a very minimal repo. That it has the minimal setup. It has one library that we want to rewrite. And I think IntelliJ does this. This is one thing I love in IntelliJ, is that it warns on this use case where it says, hey, you know, you can just do dot find instead of filter and head option. So I thought maybe we could try and implement the ScalaFix rewrite that does this. And to add a bit of extra spice into this test, let's say we have our own custom class foo with a filter method and a head option. So when we do foo.filter, we don't want to rewrite this because this is some custom implementation of filter. We only want to rewrite the one from the list. So I don't know how I can.
Oh, yeah.
Maybe this works, and I'll speak a bit louder. Is that fine? So. Is this up? Can you hear me? And so you're just gonna need quite a lot of imports, I've realized, which made me realize I should clean up the API a bit so that you can just do like import ScalaFix and then get going. And then I had quite a lot of code to start up with,
but let's just start with something from the start here. Is that if when we have, is it big enough? So if you add, so this is not the ScalaFix integration, this is the SPT Scala host, ScalaMeta semantic database. And then we have a very small build here where we say, this is a library that wants to be rewritten. And then you can write some custom libraries rewrites here. You need the ScalaFix core library just to do the patch and rewrites. And this is a, you just say, I need the semantic database of this library into my rewrite. And what the SPT plugin will do is set up the magical Java options so that you can just instantiate a mirror like this. And this one, mirror database. Let me see. I think it's this one. So here I ran mirror.database, printed it out. And this is what I was mentioning. We'll see all the names in the source file by their offsets, and then we'll see their fully qualified, like their symbol definitions. So do you know what a symbol is? Okay, maybe that's a good place to start. So a symbol is a unique identifier for a definition. So whenever we do like something like, we say like a val, we're creating a symbol here. And we're referencing the symbol right there. So it's the same when we create a class, for example, we're creating a new symbol. And then we reference it here. So this one, so basically if I say, what is the symbol of this one and what is the symbol of this one, they will both be identical. So now I just rerun it. And we see that these three have the same symbol. And we see that, for example, the library, when we create the object, that's the symbol of library.rewrite. And so the weird part here is that the symbols that end with a hash, they're types, type symbols. And the symbols that end with a dot, they're terms. So, and then you can have a method symbol too. So that is when we call this seek, it's actually this monstrosity. It's this root scala collection generic companion apply, because the standard library actually abstracts over all the collect container types. So they all use the same constructor or the same symbol. So cool. And basically, this is the API from the mirror. You have a ScalaMeta dialect, this is the database sources, and then you can query for a symbol from a reference. A reference is what could potentially have a symbol. So for example, if we'd query for the symbol of a keyword like trait, it won't give you any symbol because it's a keyword, it's not a reference. So this is just some setup that I had to show the configuration, but let's do a rewrite that does the find. And I had the implementation here because usually when you code on stage, it's kind of hard to be sharp. So what I do is we want to get this symbol right there. We want to know that the filter method, right? So here we have filter, and this is the symbol of the filter method here. And basically, so let me show here. Move it a bit closer down there. So this is just some setup, filter head option to find. We want to do a mirror, a rewrite of a mirror, and then we have this implicit mirror. And this is just the weird syntax I used earlier to extract the filter symbol. We could have copy-pasted it. But basically what we're doing here is we're saying, well, I have some code like this. Like this should compile, right? We don't have to run it. So it's okay that it would crash at runtime, but we're only type checking. We're only doing static. And here we just say, I don't care about the rest. I'm only deconstructing out the filter method. And
then you just say the symbol of that. So IntelliJ doesn't really pick this up because it takes an extension method. But we have some pretty amazing IntelliJ support already that we'll hear more about from Michael, who's working on the Scala plugin. Because this is, for example, amazing, is that we get the precise type from this destructure. And this is a custom support that they've actually added into the IntelliJ Scala plugin, that you can get the precise type from the quasi-quote deconstructor here. So this is cool. So now we have like a symbol for the filter method. So now, what ScalaMeta trees basically have collection-like methods. So you can say .collect, you can say find, exists on a tree, and what it'll do, it'll visit each node in the tree. So you basically get to treat it like a flat structure, even though it's a recursive data structure. And now we're using the same syntax as above. So these are quasi-quotes. So are you familiar with quasi-quotes here? Okay, cool. So quasi-quotes are a way. Have people written in like Lisp, like Clojure? You have these things called quotes, which means that you can lift your code into the data structure, like the abstract syntax tree, and then you can unquote. And quasi-quotes are the same. You can basically take, here we're just writing the code what it is, but we get this the data structure, the abstract syntax tree for this code. It's actually a macro that expands into all sorts of term apply, term name, it, and then seek. So this is basically the same as saying name, like this. So if we write this, it'll create this syntax tree, which is this, but we don't have to think about it. It's a lot nicer syntax to produce these large data structures. So what's cool is that we can construct trees and we can deconstruct them. So here we say tree.collect, and we'll say, okay, I only care about this filter.headOption pattern. So we say, I don't really care what you're selecting from. I want something that's filter. I don't care about the condition, but I want something that's headOption. So these are just variables. We don't know that they're actually headOption or filter. So all we have to do is check that filter, that the symbol is identical to the filter symbol that we had. And here I'm just checking that the syntax, I don't have to check that the symbol of it is identical because we know that the filter one is correct. So that one will return the same. So we just say, well, I just want to check that the syntax of this method here, which is a term name, is headOption. And then we just supply the patches that are needed to do here, because now we know this is exactly what we want to do. All that's needed is to remove this dot, this word, and rename this into find, right? For example. So we need three, basically, patches. So here, we start with the easiest one, which is there's a tree patch provided that says just rename this term name into a... Am I finished on time?
No, we have still...
Oh, wow. Cool. So... That's totally fine. So here we say the filter should become a find now. And here I say, actually, this stuff is not necessary anymore. So here I just say the head tokens, all the tokens. So this is, here we go down to the token level. Because removing a tree node doesn't always make sense. It's quite hard to just remove a tree node. Because you could, we could have a tree node that tree patch that basically just exactly this. So I just say all the tokens that belong to this head option, remove in. And then it's just the same as, you know, token, right? And then we say we also want to remove the dot. And that is basically the trickiest part, is that we don't know where this dot is. So what I do is the context has this helper called the token list. So I think that I saw a photo of Matthias showing some demo with DSL to extract the traverse spaces and comments, etc. And I think maybe we should talk about that. I think we can find something cool. Here I'm doing just, I treat the tokens as a doubly linked list, so you can like query it forwards and backwards. And I say, I just, starting with the last token in this condition, right? So starting with whatever is in here, so we'll start at 2. And then I just say, find the token that is the dot. And so ScalaMeta, I'm just jumping to the sources. ScalaMeta has a class for each keyword for each type of token, like a delimiter or parentheses, etc. So there's, you can just match on the types of the tokens. You don't have to, I don't have to check that it's a dot. You know, I don't have to write out the boom. And in some cases, it's really useful to know that you just have the types for the tokens. So, and then we just find the first dot, and then we map it to just being removed. And so now let's apply this on all of the sources in our file. So the tool basically does this kind of loop over all the sources and applies them and rewrites into the source file. But if you're doing a library, maybe you want to rewrite them somewhere else, etc. But it's quite mirror.sources, right? And now we just need to create a... and that is a rewrites... I think, yeah, so here we just need the tree, which is the source. And I have a... we can just use the default one, and then mirror. So now we have the Scala fix context. And now we can say filter head option, rewrite on this context, right? And that'll give us the patches that we have. And now we want to fix it. So we'll say fix equals patch. And now we need the patches. It takes an implicit context, this one here. So I like to keep it implicit. So and now we should have the fix. And now we can say, how does it look like fixed? And let's see how it looks like beforehand. So now we see the original source is what we had here before. And there we go. There we have the find. So it's been rewritten here. And let's make this a bit tricky now and see, you know, does it really do what we think? Like, what if I say, comment, moo, ha, 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 because people put comments in weird places, right? Just for fun. We can write this and see what it does. And what's really cool is that it preserved down to the token level everything that was written in the original source. The operations that were run on the source files were exactly remove these tokens. We have surgical precision down to the token level, what is removed.
Still, we will not work with infix notation. Okay, we have head option, it is not possible, but when it doesn't use dot, it is problematic.
Yeah. Is it really? Because I think if you remove this, now it'll just be postfix. I think you have to import it. And we just remove the head option. We didn't find a dot, so we just...
Oh. Okay.
Can you change sequence to set, for example?
Yeah, we can. So set 1, filter 2. And what's... because it's the same symbol, right? Now we don't have to. And it'll do the same thing because it's the same. And I was like, seriously, is this working? Am I over? Like, I thought this would take ages, but it actually was. Just that you can on the fly. I wanted an example to demonstrate this in the. I wanted to demonstrate something for while preparing these slides, so I implemented this rewrite, but that's about it. It's like I did it after, like while doing the slides. It's not something I've been working on this, to do this exact rewrite. So I think this is quite promising, but as Mattia showed, yeah, there's definitely quite a lot of challenges in terms of doing project-wide refactorings. When you move a class into another package, now you have to manage all the imports in all the other projects, etc. So you'd have to remove imports, add new ones. But I think we have the basics. So just to conclude, I think move fast and automatically refactor things. If you forget everything else, I think that's a good one to remember. We're focusing on batch mode, so command line first and being able to run in CI. But I think it's possible to produce diff, like just the textual diffs, as patches with some metadata, such as a description saying what is this doing. And the IDEs could just read these patches that exist as text files or whatever on the file system. And then they'd appear up as inspections in IDEs. So whenever you compile, it'll just appear inspections in your IDE saying, hey, you want to apply this thing here. These are available. And then we just have to be able to invalidate the patches when they go off sync. And yeah, I hope you believe that you can do your own rewrites. So thank you.
Questions? Yeah. So this seems really easy, maybe not really easy, but a bit easier than the code that is in ScalaFMT. How would you compare the complexity of ScalaFMT to ScalaFix?
Yes. Hello?
Yeah.
So I'd say ScalaFMT is not necessarily complex. I mean, it was just a master project. I'd never written in Meta before. And it's a shame it got useful, because then it's just this mess to maintain now. It's additional complexity also because of the line wrapping algorithm that I think is kind of a dead end. I'd prefer to use a different algorithm now. So I'd say that this is a lot cleaner. You don't have to. There's a lot of like unnecessary complexity in the formatter because of algorithm complexity, and combined with me not knowing the API so well when I started writing. So I'd say this is simpler. ScalaFix is just it's probably 600 lines of code of just writing a few class definitions. The most complicated part was knowing when to use contra variant or covariant. I learned it because the rewrite context is covariant and rewrite is contravariant. It was like the best ever when I figured out why. So yeah.
So in Mathematica, for instance, you can transform between different syntax views of a code, like at the press of the button. Do you think that's a practical application of ScalaFix?
Do you mean as to show what?
As to show like mostly de-sugared version, for instance, or just a completely different syntax of the DSL, like prefix, infix, whatever.
You should go to Michal's talk. He's got some pretty cool stuff in IntelliJ with the
I'm sure I will be.
With the macro annotations. So you can see the expanded macros in your IDE. But that is not related to ScalaFix, though.
Okay, thanks.
Oh, yeah. I think it's more of a personal question, but we are currently working on a similar thing, that an API that allows you to do migrations, as you've mentioned. Mm-hmm. Based on the API that you provide, which is actually based in ScalaMeta, and it's pretty abstract and not tied to a particular implementation of the underlying platform. Mm-hmm. We can actually load those rules and run them in the editor,
yeah,
and actually provide the same support that ScalaFix does by actually reusing the rules.
Yeah.
And code.
And you can provide your own mirror.
Yeah, we will definitely provide our own mirror.
So that's why it's a type signet T there. You can pull in whatever you want.
So there's no need to actually like batch run the compilation thing and then load the resulting fixes from text files. You can just do it in runtime.
So I think there's definitely potential here. I think that'd be really exciting to explore. Cool. Well, thank you, everyone.
Thank you.